we didn't think people were necessarily going to put the technology stack in their mission critical transactions, and they did. We're in credit card transactions, we're in clearinghouse throughputs on option trades, like you name it, they have placed this Kubernetes technology in mission critical areas. And it carries with it a lot more responsibility, a lot more dedication to make sure that things are working well for our customer base. There's an interesting pattern happening. So you have, up until 2020, a lot of people were taking a lot of monolithic applications, a lot of stuff that they use to do business, and they were lifting and shifting it into the platform. And there's benefits there, don't get me wrong. That's definitely an awesome thing to do. And we saw a lot of customers be very successful in that because it gives you a common way to ask for CPU, to ask for networking, to ask for storage, and you have a consolidation win there. But they didn't necessarily change the dynamic of how that application was working. And so from 2020, and the COVID hit into 2021, 22 to 2023, we have a lot of customers coming back to us and saying, look, we want to modernize those applications that are running on the stack now. We want to look at more lightweight Java runtimes. We want to look at a non-persistent layer, more caching. They are excited about changing the characteristics of the application now. And so we spend a lot of time this year with our customer base on that journey. We call it the MAD journey because it's modernizing application development. So there's that happening. And at the same time, you have this generative AI thing happening in our industry. And it really is a moment. When you look at the printing press, when you look at television, when you look at radio, when you look at the internet, this is another one of those moments where we're going to use technology to really change the way we react to each other and have experiences with each other. And that's going to change requirements on Kubernetes. Kubernetes will have to do more queuing of large batch jobs. It'll have to respond a lot quicker with different storage technologies. So there's a lot of nuts and bolts that have to go into sort of bringing Kubernetes up to speed to carry those platforms. We've started that process. We are the foundation for IBM's Watson X. Any AI-based solution can run on top of us. But we spend a lot of energy on technologies like Ray and like Q, InstaScale, and TGIS, and just a lot of KServe and ModelServe. There's a lot of technologies that we've put into the product that really form a nice foundation to run any solution that you want to explore generative AI. Kubernetes can't do it by itself, and it's lucky enough to sit in a very vibrant ecosystem of open source projects that come together as a CNCF. We're invested in probably 20 of them as a company, and when we say invested, we're one of the top maintainers, one of the top three spots in those communities. Open source is extraordinarily important to what we do. We really feel that people should be able to own their code. They should be able to see it, take it wherever they want, and really accelerate what they want out of the technology, not what we are providing necessarily. But in that Kubernetes ecosystem, for Kubernetes to go after AI, it will have to have some consolidation at the networking layer. We see a lot of energy right now in ingress in these open source communities, taking Envoy and taking API management and taking a mesh and sort of merging some of those concepts together and have a more efficient way to get information in and out of that platform as you're crossing infrastructures. And that'll be important with the AI use cases. On the storage front, we have a lot of people that are getting into how they leverage our Ceph, our open source Ceph, on multiple distributed cloud networks and how that can replicate itself and cache itself and move that information around more freely for these large data models to really take advantage of. OpenShift's long-term goal, and I use the word OpenShift instead of Kubernetes because we feel OpenShift itself is more than Kubernetes. It is the mixing of a lot of those CNCF projects that we talked about before. It's bringing in an application platform, a developer experience, and all these other components that it meshes together and gives you the ability to do something as an end user. But one thing that always disrupted even us was the content. The content is king. Like when we started out this path, we used something called Gears instead of traditional Linux containers as you know them today. Then we moved into Docker, and that drove a lot of what you see today in the product. That may move into WebAssembly. That may move into some other technologies. And that's exciting to us to be able to chase whatever it is that is providing the world's content and what application providers want to work in. And that's always been our mission, to give people the best experience that they want.